So this is E658, lecture 53. So far in this course, we have seen how we can go about designing a first order continuous time delta sigma modulator, figure out what the problems will be if various things are non-ideal, starting with the op amp, the unit elements in the DAC, the flash ADD converter, RC time constant shift, and so on. Most of these things will, I mean, the effect of these non-idealities will all pretty much carry through even to higher order designs. The only thing that is left out is how do I go about and synthesize the loop filter in the first place when I know that I want a high order NTF. Okay. So let's get started on that today. So let's this is easiest done through examples. So let's say the NTF desired is the second order NTF of the form 1 minus Z inverse the whole square. Okay. So the first step is to identify, you know, what kind of loop you want, and let's do the simplest thing, which is something of this form. And again, for simplicity, let's assume that we have a NRZ DAC. Okay. So if the noise transfer function is 1 minus Z inverse the whole square, what should the discrete time equivalent of the loop filter be? How will I find that out? We know that the discrete time equivalent of this continuous time loop filter when cascaded with the NRZ DAC must be of the form, so 1 by 1 plus L of Z must be equal to the NTF, which means the discrete time equivalent of the continuous time loop filter must be 1 minus Z inverse the whole square minus 1, which can be written as Z inverse times 2 minus Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse the whole square. Right? So it's 1 minus Z inverse the whole square in the numerator divided by 1 minus Z inverse the whole square. And you write 1 minus Z inverse the whole square as A minus B into A plus B, and you get Z inverse times 2 minus Z inverse. And this can be expanded as, I mean, you can expand this in partial fractions. Okay. So which is Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse plus Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse the whole square. Alright. So this must be the discrete time equivalent of the continuous time filter. Correct? So while there is a formal way of deriving a continuous time filter with this kind of impulse response, there is no time to do that in this class, and that is heavy on matrix algebra. which I'm sure you've long forgotten. So we'll try and, you know, use what do you call, within quotes, engineering intuition to figure out, you know, what the loop filter must look like. And engineering intuition is just a polite way of saying it's a hack, all right. And anyway, so it's a second order NTF. So what must be the noise transfer function at low frequencies? How will it go? At low frequencies, the noise transfer function goes as omega square, correct? Which means that the loop filter transfer function must go as 1 over omega square, which means that the there must be two integrators in the loop, okay? So alright, so there must be some term of the form 1 over s square, alright. So in general, if you have two integrator, I mean if the leading term must be 1 over s square, in general the loop filter transfer function must be of the form some k2 times s square, alright, plus k1 times 1 over s. Alright. And what else? A constant, okay. In the special case of a delta sigma modulator, what can you say about the constant? Okay, before I get there, okay, look at this L of Z. What can you say about the first impulse, the impulse response of L of Z at n equal to 0? It must be 0. Why should it be 0? Yeah, so? Yeah, that's what this is. Okay, physically it makes sense that the L of 0, okay, so the first sample of the impulse response of the discrete time filter must be equal to 0, and this is because you must have so delay free loop is not possible. Does that make sense? Okay. So, what can you say about the, so in general you must, if you have something of the form 1 over s square, a general transfer function will be of the form, k0 plus k1 by s plus k2 by s square. Does that make sense? You want to have two integrators at, I mean, you want to have the gain of two integrators at low frequency, okay? And in general, you know, a polynomial transfer function which has got a second order roll off at low frequencies can be written as k0 plus k1 by s plus k2 by s square. Is that clear? And our job is to figure out what k0, k1 and k2 r. So what is your comment on what k0 should be? Why should k0 be 0? If k0 is not 0, then the moment there is something fed into the input of the filter, it will appear directly at the output. So that is equivalent to having, there will be a loop without any delay through it, okay? So which we know is not realizable in practice. So k0 must be 0. Does it make sense? You understand? Okay. So now we need to find k1 and k2. So any suggestions on what I could do to find k1 and k2? So in other words, my continuous time filter has this form k1s plus k2 divided by s square. Alright, this is getting excited by an NRZ pulse. Okay, this is 1 and this is 1. Alright, and what am I trying to do? What am I trying to do? Forget about how I should do it. What am I trying to do? I am going to sample the output of this continuous time filter at 1 hertz, and what will I get? I will get some samples. And what should I do with those samples? I want this to be equivalent to a discrete time filter whose transfer function is z inverse by 1 minus z inverse plus z inverse by 1 minus z inverse the whole square. Okay, so I'll put a discrete time impulse here, alright, and I'll put a continuous time impulse here, and the sequence coming out, okay, so let me call this x1 of n, this is x2 of n. I want x1 of n to be equal to x2 of n. Does that make sense? If this is true, then you know the sigma delta, the quantizer in the sigma delta loop won't know if there was a real discrete time system as the loop filter or there was a continuous time filter. Is that clear? You understand? Okay. So the first job is to do what now? Find x2 of n, which is what we want. So what is x2 of n? Is the impulse response of this beast here, right? And what is this?
U of n minus 1 minus delta.
Yes, yeah, U of
n minus 1. U of n minus 1 plus delta of
n. U of n minus 1. 1 by 1 minus z inverse is U of n. Z inverse of that is U of n minus 1. So this will be 0, 1, 1, 1, and so on. Does it make sense? What about this character here? Okay. I am mathematically challenged, so can you tell me the sequence? 0, 1. What is 1 by 1 minus z inverse the whole square, guys? It is, you take 1 by 1 minus z inverse cascaded with another 1 by 1 minus z inverse. So it's simply the integral of U of n, right? So that is so that will give me 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Is this clear to all of you? Correct? And the z inverse will push the whole thing out by one sample. So the combined response therefore is 0. 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. Alright? On the other hand, what is x1 of t? x1 of t is basically the Laplace inverse of k1 by s plus Laplace inverse of k2 by s square. What is the Laplace inverse of k1 by s, u of t, k1 times u of t, alright. This is k2 times 1 over s square is r of t, correct, is the unit ramp. Does it make sense? Alright, but the x1 of t is not what we care about. What do we care about? We need to sample this at 1 hertz. So, when sampled, this gives k1 times 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, alright, and this gives you k2 times, oh, I am sorry, actually I made a mistake, no, okay, so this is not what we are after, I am sorry. I have forgotten the all important back pulse. Okay, so if I take an impulse an NRZ pulse shape and pass it through an integrator, what will I get at the output? We have done this already. This is, it will go to one. And so on, correct. So, if I, so the L inverse of NRZ pulse convolved with 1 over S, okay, multiplied by K1 and sampled at 1 hertz should give me a sequence K1 times 0, 1, 1. 1, 1, blah, blah, blah. Is that clear? See, it is important to not forget about the pulse shape. The pulse shape is absolutely important, as we saw in the first order case where we did return to 0, non-return to 0 and so on. All these coefficients will definitely change if the pulse shape changes. Alright. So, the next thing we need to do is find the equivalent of the NRZ pulse driving 1 over S square, and that goes up as, it is simply the integral of this chap, correct. So, what is the integral of this guy? At the end of 1 second it is, half, alright. Then after that what happens? It has to ramp up with a slope of 1, okay. You understand? So, K2 times the Laplace inverse of the NRZ pulse convolved with 1 over S square sampled at 1 hertz should give k2 times 0, half, 1.5, 2.5, blah, blah, blah. Alright. And what are we trying to do? We want to make k1 times 0, 1, 1, 1, 1 plus k2 times 0, half, 1.5, 2.5, etc., equal to what? We want to make it equal to the impulse response of the discrete time loop filter that we needed, which is 0, 0, 2, 3, 4, 5, blah, blah. Okay. So, what do we do now? So, k1, look at the second sample, k1 plus half k2 must be equal to 2, okay, and k1 plus 1.5 k2 must be equal to 3. You understand? Which means k1 is 1.5 and k2 is 1. Am I clear? And k2 equal to 1, you know, if you had if you have a little intuition, you can see that right away, because
just have to add a point.
At low frequency, then NTF must go as omega square, because 1 minus z inverse whole square at low frequency is nothing but omega square, correct? Which means that the low frequency gain of the loop filter must go as 1 over omega square, which basically means that, you know, it must be k2 by s square. Does it make sense? On the other hand, this k1 equal to 1.5 is not immediately obvious unless you sit and do the math. Alright. So, the loop filter therefore will look like this. Okay. Call this the ADC. All right. Does it make sense? So, alright. So, if I zero the input, for example, I mean, if all that I am interested in is getting the right NTF, there are many other topologies possible which allow me to get the same noise transfer function, alright, and the intuition about why they all work is basically simple simple signal flow graph manipulations. So, for example, one thing that so if you forget about the input for the time being, okay. This signal here, it is basically the DAC integrated once and added to. So, there is one path here which is integrated twice, okay. There is another path which is integrated only once, but it is weighted with 1.5. So, an alternate way of doing this is what do you think? The single integrator in this case is through this path. I could have used this as the, I can also use this integrator as the lone path by doing the following, which is, if I had another DAC, so this is DAC 1, this is DAC 2, alright, but the gain of this DAC is 1.5. That I can do easily by simply scaling up the current in the DAC, just a change in the full scale of the DAC. So if I had this, alright, what happens to the signal here? It is the same thing. So right now you have the single integrator path is like this, the dual integrator path is like this. Okay, all right. So what do you think are the disadvantages of this? Of course, one thing is that I'm using two DACs. All right. Okay. So as far as the signal is concerned, you can continue to add it here. Okay. So this is U. This is U. Which one? The second one. Okay. Historically, of course, these are the first types of modulators to be built. And one thing, if you kind of think about it, if you from the viewpoint of how we derived the second order discrete time delta sigma, we said we take a basic first order stage. Okay, this is a first order sigma delta. Put this in another first order delta sigma. Right, so what we found was you have integrator, you feed it back, and then you have another, put this, think of this as another A to D converter, put this, embed this inside another first order delta sigma. So that's how, I mean, this corresponds to that structure where you have in the second order discrete time delta sigma, we had 1 by 1 minus Z inverse, Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse, and you kind of have this feedback as well as this. So structurally this corresponds to that realization. Okay, but and it turns out, without getting into the detail, that the signal transfer function of both the NTF of both the loops must be the same. Okay, because I have derived one from the other. On the other hand, the STF of both the loops are definitely different. Okay, so it turns out that the signal transfer function of this has got a nice low pass character. Okay, on the other hand, this guy will have what can you say about the roll off of the signal transfer function at high frequencies here? Okay, so let me draw the signal flow graph. Let's forget about sampling for the time being, and let's say we have two signal flow graphs. One has got multiple feedback like this. Okay, the other one has got feed forward like this and overall feedback. Alright, so this is 1 over S and this is also 1 over S. And I can go and choose K such that, the loop transfer function is the same. So I guess all I need to do is, so both these have the same poles. Is that clear to all of you, or that's not clear either? These are two, forget about the sigma delta for the time being. These are two signal flow graphs. Everything is in the continuous time domain, so everything is 1 over s and k. All that I have done to remind you of some basic properties of networks, the location of the poles of the network are only determined by, are independent completely of the input, correct? So once I do that, the loop gain in both cases you can see to be the same, because in this case it is the loop is basically closed like this. So the loop gain is 1 over s square plus k by s. Alright. Similarly, this is also 1 over s square plus k by s. Is that clear? So the poles of the loop of both loops are at the same locations. So stability wise, both of them are, you know, either equally stable or equally unstable. Now, even though the two loops have the same poles, depending on how you inject the input, you can have different zeros, and the final response, the transfer function, is the ratio of, you know, the, I mean, what the poles do to what the zeros do to what the poles do. So can you comment on the high frequency, at very high frequencies, what is the transfer function from U to V do as a function of S in the top case? Pardon? It goes as 1 over S square. Why? No, no, I know it will be small, but one is a 1 over S is square is small, so is 1 over S for large S. Pardon? Yeah.
L is small, so it is like L.
Yeah, it is like L, correct? Pardon? Correct, correct, that's correct. So the signal transfer function from U to V is L by 1 plus L. So at very large frequencies, the gain of the forward amplifier is falling off. So which means that it is almost equal to L, correct? And what is L at high frequencies in the top case? 1 by S square, because this behaves like a low pass filter, okay? This has got 1 over S and this has got 1 over S. So at large frequency, this goes off as this goes off as 1 over S square at large frequencies. Does that make sense? Okay. Now what happens here? This goes off as 1 over S because the loop gain at high frequencies, this is dead at high frequency because there is a direct path. Okay. So this is at high frequency behaves as K by S. So this falls off as 1 over S. So the high frequency rejection of this is bound to be poorer than the high frequency rejection of the top topology. Okay, so so it turns out that if you go and plot the signal transfer function of this character versus this character, this will show a nice you know, low pass behavior, and then of course at the sampling rate there will be a notch because of the anti-aliase property that we have discussed. Okay, on the other hand, this guy will peak, I mean this must fall off as 1 over S, so this will peak and then lose this. So anyway, this is something that there is no time to discuss at length, but this is the intuition. Alright. So in general, therefore, there are many ways of realizing the loop transfer function. One, so if I had a third order NTF to realize, what would I do? What would my topology look like? I will have three integrators. Alright. Then what should I do? If we try to do the stuff that we did, that we derived, so this will be K3. K2. K1, K0 of course must be 0, alright. Okay. And then this goes to the quantizer and the usual stuff. Yes.
Depending upon my MTF, is K1, K2, K3, I need to solve the equations. They may not result in a convergent equation, so we need to do
this. So, that's a good question. Okay. So, what he is asking is the following. This is a question I would ask myself if I was thinking about it for the first time. So, he says, see, clearly there are multiple equations possible here, right? So k1 plus 0.5 k2 should give me 2, k1 plus 1.5 k2 should give me 3, k1 plus 2.5 k2 should give me 4. There are more equations than variables. So in this particular case, this seem to magically converge to all the equations seem to have the, if you have more equations than variables, what is what do you think is a very real possibility? There could be no solution, correct? Okay, or they could all have, in this case, happily the solution, whether whichever two values you take, all turn out to be the same. Okay, so it turns out that this is possible, this is happening only because it turns out that for a discrete time, for a continuous time system like this, it is possible to find a corresponding discrete time filter of this form. And you know, it turns out that mathematically you can show that you can always derive a continuous time equivalent like this for a discrete time filter like this, okay, which is why you are getting consistent equations regardless of which samples you equate. Oh, definitely not, because topologically, no. So you can always use a similarity transformation and then get I can have, for a given state space realization, the question is there a unique continuous time filter for a given discrete time filter? Clearly I can show you a counter example. So if I multiply this by alpha, all right, if I multiply this by alpha and this by alpha, all right, and multiply this by alpha. Yes.
Is there a unique L of S for an L of
S? Definitely not. You can find many L of S's for, just hold on. Is there a unique L of S for a L of Z? No, that's not true. Because I can, for example, okay, let's say we need to have some L of Z, like L of S whose samples are these, correct? I can always generate, so one solution is this, I can always add a sine wave which goes to 0 at all these things, correct? So which is basically means that if I add poles of the form S square, 1 by S square plus 1, okay, and its multiples, I will always be able to see, as long as the samples are 0 at those points, I can generate any number of transfer functions which have the same equivalent L of Z. So from continuous time to discrete time, it is unique, obviously, right? But from discrete time to get to continuous time, you can have many continuous time filters whose samples become the same as that of a discrete time filter. Does it make sense? Okay. Okay. Now, can you suggest what I should do? What should I do systematically to get K1, K2, and K3? What will I do? You have MATLAB with you. What will you do? I give you the NTF you want. I want rather. Okay. And ask you to go and design a continuous time filter, which will give me the desired NTF. So what will you do?
First find L of Z.
First find L of Z. Okay. How will you find L of Z? Do you use 1 by 1 plus L of Z is NTF of Z? You go and manipulate NTF of Z and generate L of Z. Once you have L of Z, what will you do? You can get the impulse response if you are doing it in MATLAB. If you are beating it out on paper and pencil, the easiest thing to do is to expand it in partial fractions, you will get some term of the form 1 by 1 minus z inverse, something proportional to 1 by 1 minus z inverse the whole square, and something proportional to 1 by 1 minus z inverse the whole cube for the third order example. From that you can go in and your knowledge of Z transforms, you can go and find the impulse response of the loop filter, correct? Then what will you do? The impulse response of the loop filter is known. What next? Or the discrete time loop filter is known. What should I do next? So I will find the impulse response of this when it is excited by a the suitable DAC pulse, right? So if it is NRZ, I will put an NRZ pulse pushing into the loop filter. If it is an RZ DAC, I will put a return to zero pulse, and I will beat it out. If you are MATLAB friendly, then you can figure out the impulse response of all these guys, you know, in a couple of statements. So in any case, even if you are not comfortable doing it, at least 1 over S cube is quite straightforward. S square, S cube, S, you sample it, then you will be able to find the impulse response at the output, okay. So, U of T, U2 of T, U of N, sorry. So, the response of the energy response of 1 over S, okay, let me call this C1 as a column vector. The response of 1 over S square, I'll call this as C2. That of 1 over S cube, I'll call it as C3. These are all column vectors which have the samples of an NRZ pulse integrated once, NRZ pulse integrated twice, and NRZ pulse integrated thrice. Okay. So this times K1, K2, K3 must give me L0, L1, L2, blah blah blah, which is, these are the, this is the impulse response of the of LFZ, okay, and this you got from 1 by 1 plus L of Z is NTF of Z. Does it make sense? So obviously there are many more equations than variables. You have only 3 variables to find, okay. So it turns out that you do any one of the you choose 3 of these equations and find out. Or the easiest thing is to do the least square solution, which MATLAB will do anyway. So if you do L0 by, if you call that right hand matrix something, you just have to do that backslash this C matrix and you will get K1, K2, K3. Does it make sense? Okay, this is what we have done for the second order example also. So this topology of the loop filter, if you look at it, it is basically a cascade of integrators, okay, and there is feed forward from every integrator to the output of the loop filter, okay. So such a loop filter is called a SIF loop filter, and SIF stands for cascade of integrators with feed forward. Okay. Now the same thing can be done using multiple feedback so so this is K1, this is K2, and this is what is this now, K1 by S, yeah. So anyway, this K3 will be one anyway. Okay, so actually it should be K3. Right, so it's K3 by S cube, K2 by S, and K1 by. So all that, and such a loop filter is called, this is a cascade of integrators but with feedback. So this is called cascade of integrators with feedback. Okay, so in either case, finding LFS is finding LFS is straightforward. You don't even have to worry about the topology. If you have an nth order NTF with all zeros at z equal to 1, then you will have n integrators in cascade plus. So for an nth order NTF of the form 1 minus z inverse whole power n divided by some d of z. Alright, we need, and I went over why we need a denominator, because otherwise the modulator will become unstable. The out of band gain is too much and it will become unstable. So for nth order NTF, this clearly means that there are n integrators in cascade, and you can go through the, so you can assume at L of S, the loop filter to be of the form S power n plus, so this is Kn plus Kn minus 1 S plus Kn minus 2 S square, blah blah blah, plus K1 S to the N minus 1. Okay, so the gain for the for 1 over S is K1, for 1 over S square is K2, and so on all the way up to Kn. And the procedure is the same, it's just that you will have many coefficients in this equation. So you will have many more columns, you will have n columns and you will have n rows in this matrix, and it's just manipulating the equations. Does that make sense? Okay. So when you have excess delay, what do you think will happen? So I think in your 7th assignment there is deliberately half a clock cycle delay if I am not mistaken. So what happens, what do you think I should do with this excess loop delay? So let us say there is this loop filter L of S. This is NRZ pulse shape and there is a excess delay. If there is excess delay, what do you think I should do? Pardon? What would we say was the fix for excess delay? We have a feed forward path with K0, that is a direct path bypassing the filter. Alright. See, when there is no delay in the quantizer, this K0 is not acceptable at all, because Joyce, why did we assume that K0 is 0 all along when there was no delay? There can't be a delay free loop. Okay. So now suddenly how does it become acceptable? There is a delay tau d. Okay. So now what happens? So how will you now go about finding K0? Now you have to find K0 through Kn. Correct? So how will you do it? You again, the equivalent of the K0 is basically 1 followed by all zeros. The direct path will just feed through with some weight of K0. Then this is the gain through the NRZ pulse integrated once, twice, blah blah blah, n times. Okay, this times k naught, k 1 all the way to k n must be L naught L 1 okay. Does it make sense? So from this, you know the matrix on the left, you know the matrix on the right. So you can go and find k naught through k. So the only difference is that this excess delay has to be incorporated in the path, in the whole calculation. So that will lead to the direct path, which whose pulse is there just for the first sample. Why are all the numbers other than the first one zero? So this is tau d. This is one. Alright, this is 2 and so on. So, through the direct path, this is the output and it has to be sampled every 1 hertz or every 1 second. So, the sampled output of the direct path will be 0, 1 times, you know, whatever the weight of the direct path is, 1 times k naught, 0, 0, 0. That's why that column is, sorry, it must be 0, 1, 0, 0, blah. Does it make sense? Alright.
So, in practice, how do you know the delay?
Oh, in practice, how do you know the delay? Well, you can enforce a delay of half a clock cycle, that's easy enough. If you have a clock cycle, clock with 50% duty cycle, you enforce it. Okay. Otherwise, you know, from simulation, you know how much you roughly have. And you compensate it for, I mean, finally you have some logic in the path, right? So, and you know the delay of the, through the entire logic using simulations. And you must compensate the loop for that amount of delay and hope that if the delay varies by a small amount around your nominal value, the modulator still remains stable, okay? You understand? A more intelligent thing would of course be able to figure out what the delay is and compensate it precisely for that amount of delay. But I think, you know, most of the time what is done is this. You kind of estimate the delay using simulations and the spread of the delay also from the nominal value using, you know, simulations, right? And make sure that the modulator remains stable. It's compensated for the nominal but remains stable if the delay changes by some small values, you know, around the nominal. Is that clear? So, the next thing is how would I realize complex zeros, okay? So, if I had complex zeros, what do you think the loop transfer function will look like? L of s. So, if all the zeros were at z equal to 1, L of s will look like, you know, 1 over s cube plus it, all 3 poles must be at s equal to 0, right? So, okay. So, now if the zeros were not at z equal to 1, but there is 1 0 here and then there is 1 0 here and 1 0 here, what do you think will happen? So equivalently it will look like L of s must look like, so the zeros of the noise transfer function must be the poles of the loop of L of z, okay? So which basically means that the L of s will be of the form, for example, if you have a third order, if I 1 0 must be at the origin and two of them must be complex, I mean if they are complex they occur in conjugate pairs. So the loop filter must be of the form S square plus omega z square times S, okay, plus blah blah. Does make sense? So again, you, the same old, which is you expand this in partial fractions, find the impulse response or the response of each of these partial fraction filters to an energy pulse, and go and do the maths. And go and invert the matrices and find the. Does make sense? So I think that should cover the. The stuff that you need to know to do your fourth assignment, okay, or whatever, seventh assignment. The last thing I need to do is dynamic range scaling, I think, which is also important for your seventh assignment. So I will do that tomorrow. So we meet tomorrow. Tomorrow is the last class.